We're talking boxing with Adi Oladipo, who's in studio, DAZN host and TalkSport's boxing pundit. We've been talking, of course, about the big fight this weekend, covered by TalkSport Live, Jonas against Meyer. But of course, last weekend we saw one of the bravest guys in boxing, I think you'd agree, Adi, Callum Smith. My goodness, never shirks a challenge, and went in with a man who looks virtually indestructible, Artur Beterbiev, and again on this occasion proved to be exactly that. Callum failed in his bid to become two-weight world champion against Beterbiev, and I'm delighted to say a member of the brilliant Smith boxing family, brother of Callum, Paul Smith, joins us live. Paul, hi to you.
Hiya, gents. She's okay. Hello, Jim.
Hello, Paul. Good to speak to you. It's been a while, mate. Great to have you on board. Adi is with us. So too, Simon. How is Callum after that brave but, I'm afraid, in vain attempt to topple Beterbiev?
He's okay. Listen, when you go in there and you lose to a better man and you lose to a champion, it's easier to take. And I can say that from experience. I think we've all done it. You know, you lose to someone who's just better, bigger, stronger, and that's how it is. You know, he's gutted, I'm sure. I haven't really spoke too much, to be honest with you. Callum's one of the quietest men in boxing, and he's like that with everyone, even his brothers and his family. You know, if he doesn't speak, he doesn't speak. He's quiet. He doesn't speak if he doesn't have to, should I say. And I haven't really spoke to him much over the last few days, just the odd text here and there, but I'm sure he's okay. He's good at putting things into perspective, and I think when you're fighting and when you're boxing, when you lose, you know, you have to look at the bigger picture. Life's a bigger game than boxing. His family's healthy, his kids are happy and healthy, he's getting married this year. You know, he's got a lot to look forward to as well. And listen, if he decides to fight on and come back again, there's still big, massive fights out there for him should he want to.
Yeah, and I hope he does, Paul. I tweeted before the fight that I think it's a tough ask. And it's a tough ask because he's fighting a pound for pounder. And there's no shame in losing to that. I mean, he lost to Canelo, who at the time was pound for pound number one. And he's fighting Beterbiev, who at worst is pound for pound number six or seven. That's who Callum's losing to. He's not losing to scrubs. And his interview after, Paul, and look, you can understand, look, he's never been stopped like that. He almost is hinting at retirement. And I kind of said, I hope he doesn't. I hope he takes some time out, because I think there are fantastic fights out there for him still. I think he's still one of the best 175 pounders. There aren't 475 pounders on planet Earth that beat Callum Smith. If he comes back, refreshes, I think he looks good under Buddy. I think he can come back and cause damage, Paul.
Yeah, me too, Simon. And as you say, you know, it's not like, in my opinion, people are always going to say I'm biased. I don't like really talking about my brother as much, because I get the usual shouts of, oh, you're going to say that. But for me, he's still probably the number one in Britain. And the fights in a domestic division at 175 in the UK alone are huge. And this thing now with His Excellency Tekhi Alal over there, he wants to get five Queensbury versus five matchroom. Callum, last fight was a matchroom. He can obviously sign a game with Matchroom and maybe fight one of the, you know, Anthony Yards over in Saudi. The fights are there for him, but knowing Callum the way I do, Simon, if he'd have won that fight, he probably could have retired in the ring. He's always said he's never in it for the money. It's not about money, it's about just being the best. He wanted to be the best. And this is a kid who wanted to get out while he was 30, and the COVID changed that, obviously, but his plans were to win a world title, become the best in the division, and then probably retire at 30, so I don't know what he's going to do, and that's saying that being his eldest brother. But if he decides to fight on, as you say, I totally agree. There's huge fights out there, and I'd back him against anyone, you know, in the light heavyweight division, as I did last Saturday.
Paul, I'd like to lay claim to the integrity of that question, but it was actually Adi. were you surprised, Paul? Because I gave Callum a real chance in this fight, because we saw certain vulnerabilities in the Yard fights that ultimately Callum could take advantage of with the style that he's got and the check left hook that he can deliver to this guy in the body. But were you surprised at how good Beterbiev was? Because he looked so impregnable. Everything that Callum wanted to do, if he wanted to fight inside, the power pushed him back. If he was on the outside, he was getting picked off. Were you surprised at the level that Beterbiev was at?
I was very surprised at how tough he was, how strong he was. And listen, people have said this, and it's hard to say without sounding like sour grapes. It's not, but he's getting better at 39. Mm. He's getting stronger at 39. He's looking bigger and tougher and meaner at 39. I'm 41, I'm a couple of years old, I've been retired nearly 6 years. I struggle getting out of bed some mornings with the pain that I've got and the injuries that I've had over a hard career. And he's been a pro, you know, equally as long, I'd say. But the small ring didn't help. Again, no excuses. A small ring probably... We said when it was small, you know what, that'll probably suit you, because people assume that because Callum's long and tall that he wants to box at a distance. He doesn't. He wants you up close. He wants to be in close. It was a case of Batavia being very good. Callum just couldn't get going, but that's what the top fighters do. When Callum lost to Canelo, he was distraught. He was sobbing in the changing rooms. He said, I just couldn't get going. And the example I used was about good football teams. They don't let you do what you do well. Mm-hmm. They're going to stop what you do and negate what you do so they can do what they do. And that's what happens on Saturday night with Batavia. He didn't let Callum get into a rhythm. He closed the distance really well. He was fit, really strong, very strong. Smart as well. No, he doesn't get the credit he deserves for being smart in there, Batavia. He's a very good fighter. As you mentioned yourself before, Sam, he's an elite fighter. He's unbeaten, 20 fights, 20 wins, 20 knockouts. And he will take some stopping, especially even against Bivol, in my opinion. But we felt, and I felt certainly, that Callum had the answers. And it wasn't to be on Saturday night. You know, as I say, no excuses. Yeah. The better man won.
Paul, I always like hearing you. I mean, you and I have many chats about the world of boxing. You've set up a boxers' union. Tell us more about that. What's the intention?
Yeah, listen, it's not me. It's not me, just me. It was an idea I had many years ago. It's been done before. It's been tried before, should I say, years ago. And it's always been from a different perspective. It's always come from a boxing perspective with ex-boxers. And I'm an ex-boxer. I know a lot about boxing. I've given my life to boxing. I've got 30 years of experience in boxing. And I consider myself an expert in boxing without sounding big-headed. But I don't know about unions or trade unions. I don't know about contracts as much as I should. I'm a big believer in putting experts in the field. I'm sick to death of seeing the government at the moment with people in charge of health who are unhealthy and not healthy and don't know anything about health. People in charge of finance who don't know about finance. I believe experts should be in the field of what they're doing. And we've come at this from a trade union perspective. We've got members of the TUC. We've got members of the PFA. We've been getting the right background checks on things and the right people advising us on things. And we just want to give fighters a fair crack of the whip. We want to work with anyone that we can, all the promoters, the boxing boards control. You know, I'm sick to death of sitting there watching fighters getting their hands wrapped, and I'm the representative from the team, and the official doesn't know what he's looking for or she's looking for. And that for me is criminal. If you're in a sport, working in a sport, an official in a sport, you should know that sport inside out. That goes for football, it goes for boxing, it goes for any sport out there. We're seeing it all the time now with football, with VAR and the people that are doing it. Yeah. VAR is a system in place, but it's also a person overseeing it. And that's the same with boxing. You know, we have some officials in boxing that don't know what they're doing.
Yeah.
We have promoters in boxing that are not paying fighters always.
It sounds great what Paul is saying there. I think it's been tried before. Well, but this time it sounds like Paul's on a winner.
Barry McGuigan tried it.
Tried before.
Go on, Paul.
Yeah, but it was purely from a boxing perspective, in my opinion. He was coming at it from a place of boxing along with other boxers, and we're coming at it from a union perspective. We've got members, as I say, of the TUC, the PFA. We've got...
It'd be interesting to see how you get it funded, Paul.
From a union perspective.
It'd be interesting. I mean, Barry...
Yeah, it will, Simon, it will.
If Barry came at it from the point of view, and he will lay claim to a lot of the medical facilities that are around the boxing rings now, were in part because of the influence he brought to bear, where he couldn't get the thing going and really get it going, was the funding of it, because ultimately it needed fighters to give up some of their purses. And this will be the interesting part, because one thing in football, getting a union funded by taking 1% of the TV monies, whole different thing. And it'll be interesting to see if the promoters come to the table and start providing some money to support fighters in circumstances like this.
Obviously, Simon, you know your stuff. You knew that straight away from the PFA. The PFA received their funding from, as you say, the television networks. There's no reason why boxing can do that. We're not going to ask boxers for a percentage of the purse. I don't think anyone should be getting a percentage of the purse. It'll be a flat fee for everyone, as the PFA is, and we'll supplement it from television networks. Maybe, you know, we can't be seen to be taking money from promoters either, because also that could be impartial. We want to make sure that healthcare is in place. If you get in that ring and, God forbid, you lose your life or you lose your health and it's a career-threatening injury or a life-threatening injury, then you should be covered by some form of insurance. Yeah. If we can have that in place for all the fighters that are signed up, when you get in that ring, at least you know you're safe and your family's safe should the worst happen. The WBC have just started doing it now, where you sign a waiver and you give your next of kin. I think it's like $100,000 or $200,000 or something, but we want to make sure that when fighters are in there, that they're taken care of, the health is taken care of. If a fight's postponed, the payments will be made to fighters so they can make the next fight and actually train. Yeah. A lot of fighters out there at the moment, they're fighting and they're borrowing money to get through training camps to then fight and pay it back at the end of it. And that's the harsh reality of boxing. It's the 1% that make a lot of the money, and it's the rest of the fighters out there in the country that are in the world that are yeah. struggling to make ends meet to get to camps to actually fight.
A very, very good point that you make. Many good points in there. Thank you so much. Paul Smith speaking to us live from Liverpool.